thanks so much for meeting with me today. You guys have such a great show, so needed right now because it's a seller's market, but some people can't sell their houses. You know, I have a question. Do you ever find that when you go to somebody's house, they're baffled why they can't sell it, and it's like so obvious to you when you walk in the door?
All the time. Absolutely. Go ahead. I'm going to shut the door. Oh, she's shutting our door. So, I mean, it happens all the time. I think when you live in a house for, you know, 10, 15, 25, 30 years or more, you start to forget about, you know, what that first impression was, what that first, what it was that first drew you to that home, because you're living there. It's mm-hmm. working great for you. It meets all your needs, but what does a buyer want? Who, you know, when we want, you know, not just a specific buyer to walk through the door, we want all of the buyers to walk through the door that are looking in that price range, because then it widens our gate and mm-hmm. we get more interest. More interest means more potential offers. More potential offers means the maximized dollar. So I think often, you know, homeowners just think, well, it's working great for me. Mm-hmm. And it's set up perfect the way that we've lived in it for 15, 30 years. Why wouldn't somebody else be able to just drop their things and move right in?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, have you ever like walked in, like, can you think back to like the wackiest living situation, like where you were like, whoa, you know, I'm sure many, but can you think of like one or two that just were mind blowing?
Well, I think, I got to whisper the last name because we're always very protective of last names.
Yeah.
This one home that you'd walk in, immediately to the left was this teeny tiny living room, and you could fit like two little chairs. Then there was this big wall that had just one small coat closet in it. Then the rest of it was literally just taking up space. You'd have to walk around this wall to get to a divided dining. Then you'd have to, again, another wall. That was like a horseshoe to walk around to get into a kitchen. And then one more that was a horseshoe to walk around to get to another living room.
But these were all kind of floating walls.
Yeah, so you literally walked in, it was like loop, loop, loop. So it was so bizarre. And we stood there for a minute like, we can honestly say we've never seen this layout before. Yeah.
But even beyond that, it's things like people have their homes listed and they have mattresses in their living room because that's where their, you know, kids are sleeping, or, you know, they have their, you know, 19-year-old's daughter's boyfriend staying with them or whatever, or they happen to have several, you know, reptiles, and they have all of the, you know, the, you know, tanks with all the red lights and da da da. And it's just like that. I mean, everybody has a lifestyle. Everybody has a way that they live, and that's great, but it's not always the best way to sell, you know? Yeah. And that's the thing that always blows my mind is how can you not see the difference between how we present a home when we live and when we go to sell? It's two different things. We always say, we're not going to stage or design or, you know, renovate this home for you.
Yeah.
We're going to do it for the masses.
Yeah.
It's not always the way that I like a house, but it's not about me. It's about who's buying right now.
Yeah. And we always remind the seller, there's a really good chance you're not going to like it. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, sellers are 99% of the time super nice about it. And, oh, I love this. And that was so smart and da 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 da. But they're very honest. They'll tell us, I don't like gray.
I don't like gray. I prefer red walls.
Or this,
like, yeah, we know.
Yeah, this year we did a house with, and I'm just giving a little sneak peek, a house with some blush backsplash tile. And these particular homeowners were like, not for me. And they were really taken back. And I said, I get that, but this is the perfect young first-time home buyer home. And we got multiple offers. It was competitive. waived everything, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, over list price. And they were just like, whoa, like shocked. And I had to remind them several times as they were walking through, it's not for you. Yeah. Remember, this wasn't for you, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And you know how everybody thinks that they have really good taste, you know, and you guys are perfect the way you approach your clients. You know, you're not like harsh, like roll, you know, bulldoze them, but like, how does it, do you handle it when they're like, this is so beautiful. And why would you, you know, how do you sort of work through that without getting them all offended?
Yeah. We tell our agents and our brokerage all the time, you have to get them to trust you first. You can't go in and just be brutally honest. You have to get them to trust you. You have to build that relationship, and then they're going to know you have their best intentions in mind. And so then they can let down their guard and hear you. You know, I often say to sellers, this affects you for a lifetime. This affects me for just a moment, for 60 days, 90 days. This is one moment for me. This investment, this return on your investment, this purchase is going to make or break what your next purchase looks like, your retirement, your kids' college fund, whatever it may be. So I am doing all of this with the intention of getting you the best results. So please know that. And they're going to know that. And they're going to know that that's my genuine heart once they get to know me and they trust me. So we have to build that relationship first. I can't come in guns a-blazing and be like, oh my God, I just walked in your door and this is too much, you know? To first get them to understand, okay, I have the right motives, and then I'm going to tell them this is too much. Yeah.
Yeah. And then that also brings me to the whole, investing some money for the return on investment, which that also has to be kind of hard to get them to part with their money to make it better. How do you guys work through a budget and create something so that you get what you want to do, but they're not freaking out about the money?
Yeah. So it started, you know, Les and I were doing this concept well before the TV show, but when we started, it was very small. It was, you know, hey, this, we know this homeowner could sell for more if they had fresh carpet or if the interior was painted. Started with, you know, $5,000-$7,000 investments. Then it was, you know, new carpet and landscaping, you know, we got up to 10, 15,000. Then it turned into maybe a roof and some landscaping. So we kind of slowly climbed. I think when we, you know, got to the point that it was, you know, 25,000, 30,000, 40,000, it was like, yikes. Okay, 40,000, we're going to pull out of our bank account, put into an investment for, you know, sometimes 60 days, we have to get a return on that. Nobody else out there is going to loan you that money and not get a return.
Yeah.
It was us doing basically renovations for free.
Yeah.
So we said, okay, we will loan you this money. We will do this work. But this is how the breakdown, you know, we feel is reasonable. And I think the more we could show them our track record and the more we could show them, this is what this person had the home listed for, then this is what we ended up selling it for, over and over and over and over, people really just started lining up and saying,
this
what do you want to do? Just tell me what you want to do to the house.
That's, yeah.
And I'd say for every 10 houses we look at, we maybe invest in one.
Yeah.
You know, not every house makes sense, even if it needs a lot of work.
Yeah.
It may not be the right location. It may not be the right layout. It may have too many projects. It may not have enough projects. It may not be the right personality of the homeowner and us. You know, we have to be on the same page of what this process looks like, what the risks are for us, what the risks are for them. You know, I mean, there's a lot that goes into it. You know, there's real estate is already one of the biggest decisions and biggest, you know, transactions you're going to have in your life. And then now we're putting a whole second transaction on top of that.
Yeah.
So it has to be a complete, you know, agreement. And we have to make sure that we work really well together in order for us to be able to do this second layer. And so it's not everybody that we come in contact with. And often they'll say it's not a right fit, or we'll say it's not a right fit.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, you know, have you ever walked into a house though, and you were just like, no, I can't, I'm not going to.
All the time. All the time. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
And we're like, let us meet, introduce you to one of our other agents. Yeah. They would love to work with you.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, and what else is interesting, I find it in this market where a lot of people, you know, I live in Florida, which, you know, is like out of control.
Yes.
You know, my son's renting a house right now, half of it's sinking into the earth. And this woman's like, I put it up for $500,000. And she's, you know, it's crazy town there.
Crazy. Yeah.
But like, you know, is there anything that you think sellers can get away with as far as selling and not doing? Because like I said, you know, people are selling it with half the house falling off.
Yeah, you can absolutely sell anything right now. Anything is sellable. And we say that all the time. It's not that there's unsellable houses. It's that you're not going to sell at the highest price that's possible. Okay. So we sell homes all the time that sellers don't want to take the time, take the money, take the effort. You know, every seller has a main driving factor, and we figure that out first. What is it? If it's timing, it doesn't always make sense to make changes because it's not money. They want to get this transaction done in the next 20 days. Great. We have a different direction we're going to go than if their main driving factor is top dollar. That's a whole nother conversation. So we have to figure out what is that seller's goal. And then we back into, okay, here's the best plan for that specific seller.
Yeah.
And it could be two neighbors, and we go at it completely different strategies because those two sellers have completely different goals.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's really the beauty of how you guys work. I do love how you guys are, you know, twin sisters and you get along and, you know, I mean, how is it? Do you kind of go at it a little bit, you know, cause you seem to just, but you get through it.
Yeah. Yeah. We bump heads sometimes,
sure.
But
yeah.
It's like, out of everybody in the world, I argue with her the least, you know, like we will bicker, but it's more like play bicker, you know? Yeah. So, no, I mean, we get asked all the time, how do I duplicate this partnership? We've been partners since my mother's tummy, you know,
yeah.
I mean, it's 40 years of a partnership. I don't know that you can duplicate that. My husband and I are 20 years in and we'll never catch up to this partnership. So,
yeah.
I mean, it is what it is. It's a relationship you can't duplicate.
Oh, twin power.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's so interesting because, you know, real estate shows are so fascinating. People are just, they can't get enough of them. What do you guys like? What do you watch when you're...
Oh, total opposite.
Totally opposite.
Okay.
I am all about the feel good.
Yes.
Yes. I'm feel good and comedy. I like happy endings and tune out. I am 90% of the
time.
She
wants to know what the ending is going to be
before I get there.
Yeah, within the first 30 minutes, you have to predict everything that's going to happen.
I'm either folding laundry or playing a game on my phone while I'm watching that show.
Yeah. I love like dark mysteries or like
really gritty stuff.
Yeah, like the gritty shows or just like old school war movies.
Mm.
Like, just stuff like that. I know, so different.
Yeah. She watches them at like 3 a.m. in the morning.
Oh, yeah.
And I've already been sleeping for 8 hours.
Yeah.
So we're totally, totally opposites on that.
Oh,
I wake up running. She wakes up, you know, needing 2 hours to adjust to the day.
I love that. I love that. So are we watching Selling Sunset at all? Or is that?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we agree on that one.
Yeah. We agree on that one.
Okay. What is your opinion about it? Because I know I've talked to some of the Million Dollar Listing guys and they are shady about that show.
It's good drama.
It's good drama.
I mean,
it's
good TV. I mean, if I could do an open house with Botox and burgers, I would.
Yeah.
You know, I would attend it.
Or this year, Chanel and, no, it was Caviar
yes.
and Couture.
Oh, yes.
Caviar and Couture.
That we could never pull that off. We
no.
would have like hot dogs and soccer balls.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And like just, it would never fly.
No.
Hot dogs and Band-Aids.
Yeah.
That's perfect. So what do we have to look forward to for the remainder of the season? We still have a few more episodes.
We have a lot. Nine.
Yeah.
What can we tease that we're going to be?
Oh gosh.
Oh, I think this,
is it? Oh yeah, this next week you meet a new Volkswagen.
Ooh, really? Oh,
actually, it has some crazy history to it.
Yeah, it's a very fun one.
Very fun.
What else can we tease?
Let's see.
It's just so hard because we don't see the episodes first.
Right.
So yeah. I don't know what makes it or not. There was an episode, and I don't know if this made it in, where Leslie and I got into I bet it'll be this. I bet it'll be that. Then, you know, we'll take it to, how did we decide on that?
The paint. I don't know.
Was it that we voted or we had, we put it on social and let them vote?
I don't know, but it ended up with her hitting me with a stick.
I didn't mean to. I went and threw it and it just goes, boom.
Right across the face. I'm sure that makes it. But we made our largest profit ever on an investment this year.
Ever.
So that's towards the end of the season. We've done some of the biggest houses we've ever done this season.
Yeah.
Some of our largest investments this year.
Yeah. One of my favorite houses with that blush.
Yep.
Yeah. So and we get to do a little cross with one of our other favorite
shows,
HGTV shows.
Yeah.
Where we get to, you know,
call them in
and ask for their advice. Yep. And some of our friends that we met on Rock the Block.
Yes.
We're on Rock the Block.
Lots of fun things.
Yeah. Well, we met them on
Rock. Oh, you met them. Okay.
Yeah.
Can you give me a hint?
They're two cuties.
Yes.
Oh, I think I might know. Okay, yes. Cool. All right. Well, before I let you guys go, how are you guys going to spend Mother's Day this weekend?
She's coming to my house and
barbecue.
Our husbands will barbecue.
Perfect. That sounds ideal. That sounds wonderful. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate your time today. Now you've really got me thinking about that crossover. So
yeah,
we'll just have to stay tuned.
All right.
Thank you.